Good evening. My name is Chris Crandall, and I have attended Blythefield for almost 14 years, and I am humbled. I just can't find words to express what it means to me to have my dear friend Deet here. Back when I was in high school, God divinely appointed me to read Corrie Ten Boom's book, The Hiding Place. And many of you are familiar with that book and familiar with her story of courage and strength. And I read that story, and God has used that over the years to draw me to himself, to show me what faith really looked like. And so I can say that Corrie was my human hero. About 6.5 years ago, I had a friend. Her name was Renee Pagel, and many of you who know me know that I am a voice for Renee. She was murdered 6 years ago in August, and God has called me to speak up for her, for justice. And a few months before her death, she was at my house, and she said, told me about her friend Deet. And I said, you are kidding me. I want to get to know her. I want my kids to get to know her. I want to have her over to my house for dinner. I want them to know her story. Of course, by then, Corrie had passed away, and there was no chance of meeting her. And Deet was friends with Corrie. They were in the same prison together. They were personal friends after the war. And in fact, I went into Renee's house after her death, and I was going through her books, and I found Corrie Ten Boom's book, The Prison Letters, and I opened it up, and it says, to Renee, Psalm 27, my favorite, I translated this booklet for Corrie, Love Deet, Ecuador, 91. And it was just, I stood there, I will never forget that moment in all my life. It was God just using all this tragedy for me coming together and speaking to me in a way that said he will use everything for his good for those of us who love him. And before Renee's death, I had dinner with Deet, and I heard her speak and tell her story one time. And really, it was only through the tragedy of losing our mutual friend that she and I have become the dearest of friends. And I am so thrilled to have her here tonight, because that story and just what Matt and Louie talked about this morning and the direction our country is going in, it's scary. It's scary. And Deet is an example of standing up and making choices for what is right. And she did it at no small expense. She, in one day, found out that 9 of her dearest friends, including her fiancé, were murdered. And yet she continued to go on and stand up for what is right. My prayer is that you will be incredibly inspired by her story tonight as she shares it. She is an amazing woman, and she is, and I love her dearly. She is my girlfriend, and we laugh together and cry together, and she is a gift to me, and so it is my honor to share this gift to all of you tonight. She will be signing books out in the foyer afterwards for anyone who may be interested. So it is my pleasure to turn this over to Deet Eamon.
Thank you. Thank you. I always say, if you had been there, you would have done exactly the same, because it was, well, we didn't know what would happen. But I first want to say that I remember that when I was a little girl, they say, what do you expect of life? And I thought, well, it will be just, we sang a beautiful song, that if your life goes different than you had planned, and that surely happened with me, because if they had said you will ever be in a prison, I would say never. I would obey the government, I obey God's law as much as I can, and then you don't get in prison. But sometimes what we sang, your life goes totally different. Anyway, I was in the Netherlands. I was born there. And next door, when I was about 13, Hitler came to power. And we thought that idiot, he was screaming on the radio and he yapped and he was, we always laughed when we heard him. But we never thought that it would get so very dangerous. And what he did a very wise thing. He took all the young people in Germany and they were forced, it was not a choice, they had to go in the Hitler Youth. And in that Hitler Youth, they were all taught and their thoughts were poisoned. They were told that all the evil in the world was due to the Jews, and he hated the Jews. Anyway, all those young people, they were maybe 12 and 13, and they did sports and acted the Boy Scouts, and they had lots of fun, but every time when they came together, their minds was poisoned. And when those kids were about 17, 18, that was when I was about 18, there was all of a sudden a whole thing in Germany. It was called the Blitz Night. And they went to all the synagogues, to the Jewish stores, and they broke all the windows. It was the streets were covered with glass, and they killed many Jews, and 30,000 or something I read somewhere were taken prisoner. For what reason? Only because they were Jewish. Now, I mean, we have nothing to say if we are born Jewish or black or white or yellow, we have nothing to say. That's what God decides. And anyway, then it started. Hitler took Poland, he took Czechoslovakia, he took Norway. The Norse put up a fight. The Swedes let him through because Sweden has loads of ore mines and Hitler bought for millions to make weapons. And so they didn't fight, but the Norse fought. And then we were scared because there was only France had a president and they gave over. Spain had the president Franco, he was pro-Nazi. So the only little country was the Netherlands and Belgium and Luxembourg. And we prayed that it wouldn't happen. And Hitler spoke the evening of May 9. I still remember because I heard it. And we were all scared in the Netherlands. And he said, I know that the Dutch people are scared, but they don't have to be. They have never been in a war. And these were his own words, I will respect their neutrality. And while he was saying that, they marched already in our country. But now you have that, but that we heard that much later through the radio, because there was, of course, not TV or anything. And they were marching in. And they took all the cities and they made all rules in our country. And I've only an hour, and this covers 5 years. But they made a whole curfew. We were not allowed in the street between 11 and 6. And if we had been naughty, well, in their eyes, we had to be home at 8. Then they started that we had all to have ration cards, care cards here. And this is a small one, but that you can see. You were not allowed to go on the street, not even to get your mail if the mailbox was fired. You had to have this with you. And this was your name and your job and your fingerprint and your thumbprint. And you had always to have this with you. And if you didn't, then you went to jail and you got a big fine. So that's how it began. But then all of a sudden, we have such a small country. It's the smaller than Rhode Island. And everything was registered. If a baby was born, the father in that city had to go and report him. And on that, her, and the name and the address, but it also said your religion. So they had at their fingertips who were Jewish. And then they started on the Jewish people. They weren't allowed to go, let's say, to a swimming pool, they were only allowed in a few streets, and for the rest, nothing. They had to leave their government jobs. The non-Jews were forbidden to do business or even talk to Jewish people. And the Jewish people, were not allowed to come on visitors anymore. It was horrible. And I was working in an office, and next to me was a Jewish guy. And he played beautiful violin. And my parents loved music. We had an organ, a piano. My brother played cello. His name was Herman, and Herman came very often to our house. He was there all the time. And then they started, the non-Jews were not allowed to have the Jews anymore. So we said to Hitler, to Herman, the heck with Hitler, you can come if you want to. He says, but you know, he was scared. He said, I don't dare. And his sister was Rosa. And then they started, and that's when we were so furious, and that's why we started. Those Jewish people had been in the Netherlands since 1600. They lived mostly in Spain and Portugal. And in that time, the Catholic Church was persecuting, and everybody was, the Jews were branded, and they lost their jobs. And they did not go to Austria, they did not go to Germany, they came by the thousands to the Netherlands. And when all this happened in Germany, the German Jews came to the Netherlands. You remember the story from Anne Frank. She was a Jewish girl who grew up in Germany. So we had in our little country, that 8 million people, we had so many Jewish people. And then Hitler started. We weren't allowed to do with them anymore. And then all of a sudden it said they had to report. And like Herman and his father, and then they got notices, and he showed me the letter. He phoned me. He said, "Diet, we have a letter. I want to show it to you." And I said, "Come to our house." He says, "I don't dare. And you may not come to my house either." So we met in a street where the Jewish people still were allowed. And he showed me a letter, and I was furious. If you think that many of them lived there since 1500, had a right to be in the Netherlands, and those rotten Nazis had no right to be in our country. They had occupied us. So, and that letter said, you have to report then and then, at, and always in the curfew hours, at the railroad station. And you will be brought to Poland, and all the Jews came there from all the countries, and then they can only harm themselves. So Herman and his father and all the Jews had to leave everything behind. Now, I mean, you have, and especially the women, you have heirlooms in your family. And they were only allowed to have one suitcase, a small one that you could carry for per person. So they had to leave everything that they had worked for and everything behind. And they had to go. And so, almost during curfew, that we couldn't do anything. And there they went. And when Herman called me, he said, "Diet, I want to see you." And we met in a street still, because he didn't have his yellow star. They had to have yellow stars. I have one here. It's probably here in my thing. And that thing, yeah. They had to have, so if they took their star off, but the Jewish star, yeah. Anyway, if they had that off, but some people looked so Jewish that you could really see they were Jewish. And then they all were sent away. And we never knew what would happen with them. They said they would be sent to Poland and they had to work there. But we now know what happened. But when that happened, I was so indignant that that would happen to Herman, his family, his sister. And I was dating a wonderful young man, a Christian boy. He was the oldest of 10 kids. And his father was the principal of a school in a very Christian area with all farmers. And I was dating him, and I said, "Herman has to go to Germany, or they have to go in the train." And Hein right away says, "I have read the book that Hitler wrote, Mein Kampf." He says, "And they hate him. He's going to do something terrible to him." He says, "Herman can't go." I said, "What can we do?" And then we were discussing, what can we do? And then Herman got a great idea. He said, Hein got a great idea. He said, "You know, where my father is the principal, I know all those farmers, and the kids go to, and I know them, they are like friends. And if I ask any of those farmers if they will take Herman for the duration of the war," and we thought that would be 1 year, maybe 2 years, never dreaming it would be 5 years. And he says, "I know that farmers will take them." So I told Herman, And he was so happy, and his sister too. And then he told others, and within 2 weeks we had a list of over 60 Jewish people who asked if we would bring them to the farmers. And we brought a whole bunch. And then there was food. But then the Germans took all the food, and in trains it went to Germany. And there was very little food in the Netherlands. And now it jumped to the last year of the war. It was so bad, there was nothing. Everything was on ration cards. And the people in the big cities in Amsterdam, The Hague, and Rotterdam ate cats and dogs. And if you had a cat and you loved it, keep it in the house. If it was out, you would never see it again. It was terrible. And then we got all ration cards. And you got them when you were 16. And then you had every month to go, I have some ration card. Maybe you see it there. Anyway, we had to go to, but we were hiding all those people. And you had to go to German offices with your ID and show that. And then you got your ration card. This is a ration card. See, it's, you can't see it, but this is it's still a real one. And then it said, this week you can get, here it said, Hein and I got our wedding license. And then you got some linen and whatever. Everything was on rations, and they stole everything and it went to Germany. And here was a coupon for bread. So you went with your money, and it was only in a certain week that coupon fell. You went to the store, and they didn't have it. It was horrible. But that was very difficult, because the people who had taken Jews in, and at the farms they have always some food, but they also, we had also hidden them in the cities, there were so many. And they said, we can't feed them, we haven't even enough. The coupons for a month was not even for eating normal. For 2 weeks, it was so little. So then it was desperate, because the people who had the Jews, they wouldn't get ration cards, and they said to us, we can't keep them, we can't even feed our own family. So we got, as we were 13 people, and 8 of us worked in the same area, and we got together and we went on our knees and we said, Lord, we don't know what to do anymore, but you know they need food and we don't know what to do. Because we need ration cards. And when we got up, it became clear to us that after the prayer, it became clear that we had to do robberies on the German offices to steal the ration cards. So, and that's when the danger started, because there was a death penalty on it. So we had a little group of men, and it was forbidden to have weapons, but England dropped weapons, so we had revolvers. And then every month we picked for first we scanned a little place out. And it possibly if the guy who was in charge in that office, in that city or village, was on our side. And then we said, we are going to do that. And he drew a drawing of where the cards were kept. And so every month we went on our knees and we prayed to God for protection. And after prayer, we did a robbery. And you know what? It always works. They got out safe and sound. And they didn't take just if we had, let's say, 50 Jews hidden. They took hundreds, so we could give it to all the underground and we helped. And then it became more and more dangerous. And Hein was the leader of our group with another guy, with Ab. And he said, Dieter, I got a tip. And in The Hague there is an address. And that is so dangerous. But it's necessary that you go there. They need help. So we prayed first. And he said, they won't even let you in. There is a password which you have to say. And then they answer. And 5 or 6 times you had to say the same another sentence. Then they knew it was okay. So I went there, and it was in the heart of The Hague, on the 2nd floor in an apartment building. A small, small apartment. A woman alone lived there. She had one small sitting room, a small bedroom, a kitchen, a small kitchen, a hall, and a toilet and a shower. That was all. And so I went there, and I knocked at the door, and they didn't open. So I said the password, and they said something. In the end, they opened the door, and I didn't know what I saw. Because like I say, we had when at the most a couple on a farm here, a farm there. And I came in that small place, and the woman's name, she was single, and she was in her 50s, and her name was Mies. And she had 27 Jews in this little place. And she had a golden heart, but she didn't see the danger. And while I talked to him, I said, where do you put them? It looked like a divan, but that were all piled up mattresses. And she said, when it's night, we spread them all on the floor. And she had a very old Jew, and she had a young woman who was expecting a baby. And then while I was talking to her, I hear next door that they flushed the toilet in an apartment next door. And I got the scare of my life. I said to Mies, do you hear that? She said, yes. She didn't even see the danger. I said, you have 27, which you included 28. How often does the toilet go? I said, do you know your neighbor if they are Nazis? She said, I don't know. I said, well, this is very, very dangerous. I said, you have to make rules that they only can go and flush only for... anyway, that Mies was so golden heart, but she did not see the danger. So then I said, I'll try to find places, but it was already much further in the war that the people who were willing to do it had them. But those who were not willing, you know, you don't even want to ask because it was dangerous that you knew you were doing that. So anyway, here and there, I could still place. And I said, she had 27. I had her down to 7 because we had to find and Hein helped and all our guys helped. And then I come the next time and she had again taken 10 new ones in. I was desperate. I said, Mies, I said, and you don't see the danger, you will be arrested. I said, and I'm from now on scared to come here because I can come and the Gestapo was sitting him's open arms. But in the meantime, also what she was doing, and I didn't know that, she has kept a diary. And of course, she said, what is your name? I thought, no. So I gave a false name, Toos. And she said, where do you live? I said, I'm not telling you because in my opinion, you will be arrested. So she said, how can I reach you? I said, well, I'll call you the moment that I get up in the morning, and I was working in an office. I said, and if you need me, I'll come a moment before the office, and I'll have an hour lunchtime. I'll call you an hour before the lunchtime. If you need me, I can come then, and I'll call you an hour before the curfew. So that's how it worked. And then when I told you that I had her down to 7, and in the end, she had to count 23. And I was desperate. I hardly dared to go there. So, and I said, from now on, I call you always about 5 minutes when I'm close by here, and you answer the phone. Don't let the Jewish people do nothing, only you answer the phone. And so she had been doing it for weeks, and one day I phoned, and a man answered. And I got furious. I thought, see, that is Mies again. She doesn't, so I hung up. And an hour later, I called. A man answered. At noontime, a man answered. 4 o'clock in the afternoon, a man answered. And she lived on the second floor, and on the main floor, there was a little food store. So I took some of my coupons, and I went there, and I thought, then I'll see. And everybody was talking about all the Jews that were arrested. And I thought, oh, I never told Mies where I lived and who I was, but you never know what she found out. So I didn't dare to sleep home. So I didn't sleep home. I slept at friends on the outskirts of The Hague. And I told my parents also that maybe the Gestapo would come. The Gestapo was the Geheime Staatspolizei, the secret police. And we dreaded those people. They were so mean. And they were also, if you were arrested, that was anybody out of the public who was a Nazi could be a judge. And if they were that morning, if a Jew was arrested and got a trial that he had to come before the judge, those people, Then if they were in a bad mood, they sentenced everybody to death that day. It was horrible. We lived in constant fear. So anyway, I was hiding. But after 2 weeks, when nothing happened, I came back home. And then one day, I'm at my office, and my brother phoned. He had false papers that he was in the food supply, then you didn't have to go to Germany, because all the men between 16 and 45 had to go to Germany for forced labor. And so you hardly saw a young man anymore, except if you're special. And we had stolen a paper for my brother that he was in the food service, so he was okay. But then he phoned me, and he said, "Diet, there were two guys here at the door, and they asked about you, and they pretended to be Jewish people, and if you could find a place for them." He said, "But they couldn't even speak good Dutch. They spoke half German." So he said, "This is not okay. Don't come home." Because they asked me, "When you come home?" And I said, "You come always home 7 o'clock. They said, "Oh, we'll be back." But I came home 4:15. So of course I didn't go home. And sure enough, they came at 11 that night. And they said, "Where is she?" And my father and mother did like I was a terrible kid. They said, "Oh, she hangs out with the wrong crowd, and we don't know where she is. And we have so much heartache." And then they came back the next morning. Now, a girl of 21 in a Christian home. And they said, "Did she comb the home the whole night?" And they said, my parents said, "That's what we have to put up with." So I was this terrible kid. And they came 2 weeks every night. And then after 2 weeks, they told that they were Gestapo and that they wanted to arrest me. So then I could never go home. And I always feel like David. Remember, he had to flee for Saul, and I had to flee for the Gestapo. And that also lasted 2 years. So I was for 2 years a fugitive, sleeping here, sleeping there under false names. And I make it now short, because in the meantime, the work went on. And we did the robberies and everything. And there was the death penalty on it. And then one day I was in this. Hein was also the leader of our group. And he was arrested in the train. And he had false papers, and I had false papers. But they searched him, and he had a lot of spying stuff on him and things that were forbidden. So he was put in prison, in a concentration, first in a terrible prison. And I heard that because he saw a chance, and that's what I want to show, that little paper here. When he was brought to Germany, when he was brought to Germany, we in the camps and in the prison, the only thing we got from the Red Cross was toilet paper, a little bit every month. We had horrible food, one slice of green bread in the morning, one slice in the evening. But we got from the Red Cross because Germany had signed the Geneva Convention. And that said that prisoners had to have once a month a good meal from the Red Cross. And then in that package, there was also toilet paper, because we didn't get toilet paper or anything. And so Hein, when he was brought to Germany, we didn't know what happened. He had also all of a sudden disappeared. And then they found this next to the railroad. Now, it was in October, and we had so much dew and rain, and it was on toilet paper that should have dissolved. And I think God was so good, because this is now not the real one. It's in a museum in the Netherlands. But this was a faithful copy. And on this he wrote that he unexpectedly had been arrested. It was in fake language. And that he now sat in the train. And it turned out he went to Germany to a terrible camp, Neuengamme. But he had false papers. And all our guys had false papers, because the only men who didn't have to go to Germany were priests and pastors. So all our guys became of the false papers. They were all pastors. I worked with a very religious group. But anyway, he was brought from this camp where he was Neuengamme to Dachau. In Dachau, there was especially a part for pastors and priests. But he died in the camp. I don't know what happened. And the friends couldn't tell me because he had made many friends. And also from many people later I heard who had been in the camps and came back, your fiancé brought me to Jesus. So he worked in there. And that makes me so happy that he did that with dying people because many were killed. Anyway, the letter said that he didn't know what would happen. And even if we don't see each other here on earth again, we will never be sorry for what we did. And that is what makes me so happy, because he could easily say, oh, this was stupid, we should never have started it. And I want to tell the young people here also, you don't know, and we sang that song, that our life often goes different than we hoped and what we expect. And that surely happened with my life. I never, if they said one day you will be in prison, I do to say never. I obey the laws, but we don't know what happens. But one thing is, if whole life is making choices, from the beginning, if you're little, every day you have to make a choice between simple things and between difficult things. And I want only say, if you, for your faith, and we live in a difficult time, we don't know what's going to happen, but if you have to make a decision, even if it asks sacrifices, make the right decisions. When you have a religion, you have guidelines. If you don't have a religion, you have a little voice here, and listen to that voice. Because if I hadn't helped them, and many of the people who survived, and what all happens, and you thought, I was there, and I didn't do a thing. How can you live with yourself? Make the right decision, whatever it costs. And God has promised, because I have to tell you this too. In our church, you are baptized, and then you study the Bible, and then at a certain point, what we call, you make professional faith. Then you come for the church, and you make professional faith, and then you get a text. And that was before the war. And I got such a beautiful text, really, that applied. Therefore, from Ephesians 6, therefore put on the armor of God, that you will be ready for the evil days. And that is what I got a year before that I really went in this world. And then I think I needed the armor of God for the evil days. That was because we were not fighting, we were fighting against evil spirits, because this was plain from the devil what Hitler did. But anyway, we did those robberies and everything. And then Mies had a diary, and they came to my parents' house. And for a long time I was roaming around, a fugitive. And then one day, Hein was arrested, and he smuggled a note out to the other leader, Ab. And Ab called me, and we also had a special signal, because sometimes, and we love that, your guys, your American guys, they came, flew over to bombard Germany, because Germany had been bombarding England so terrible. So your guys from America, and I'm eternal grateful to Americans. They could have stayed behind the Atlantic Ocean, and they came to help us. And they dropped their bombs on Germany. But sometimes they were shot down over our country. And everywhere was saying, if you help one of those guys, you don't even get a trial, you will be shot on the spot. But they were all 21, 22 brave young men, so we helped them too. And so, and if that happened, I had to drop everything, and then they had beautiful boots, and there was nothing anymore, so we had to dress them real poorly, and then I had to pretend that it was my boyfriend, and I had them to place it. But if I'd been stopped, I would have been shot on the spot. And after the war, I don't know whoever, we helped several guys, and they must have told, and I got a personal thank you note, and I have it on parchment from Eisenhower for helping me. So I have that personal, I'm so proud of it. But anyway, yeah, I mean, can you imagine, from Eisenhower, he's my hero. Anyway,
Then
when Hein was arrested, he smuggled the note out and he said, Diet, take yourself a false name because they know your name that you have, and warn all the guys, because what we did always is it was so dangerous to have stuff on you. But if we stole hundreds of ration cards, the people were hiding me. I couldn't take those ration cards, because if I was arrested there with hundreds of ration cards, they would have put the whole family against the wall and stole them. So we always had a P.O. box, and that's where we stopped all the stuff in. So then I had to empty the P.O. box, and oh, thank you. And I had to bring it to The Hague. And in The Hague, there was another guy who would take care of it. And I had it all here in my envelope, in my blouse. And I step in the train with my false paper. And here, I need that card again, here. You know what happened? We all got this in 1940, 41. And it had here a little sign, nationality, Nederlander, nationality, Dutch. And they were printed in 40, 41. But in 43, because everybody who was 16 got one, and they ran out of those. And they printed, and the Gestapo and the resistance. That was like a chess game. They did that, we did that. But here they had a good set, because this had to be printed new, and they did everything the same. But here, national Netherlander, that was in deep, deep purple. And in the print of 43, they did it in black. And we did robberies, but we didn't know that. So we had stolen those, and they were printed in 43. But the dates of the people who had it was often 42, and I had one of those too. So I sit in the train quiet with all that stuff here, and all of a sudden they hopped on every train and started inspecting. They stopped you in the streets and started inspecting. They were everywhere, the Gestapo. So I gave this, and the train was full, so it was packed, because a large part was for the Germans, only for the Germans, and we had to be crammed in one or two wagons. So anyway, I had this, and so this guy comes in, and he sees it, and he gives it back, and I thought, nice, they are not studying it, because I had just this brand new, I had smudged it. But anyway, he comes to me, and he does not give it back. And then he said in German to me, Wann haben Sie das bekommen? When did you get it? I'm fluent in German. But I'd made a vow I would never speak it till they had left my country. So I said, stupid, I don't know what you're saying. Can you speak Dutch? And this went on. But there were 6 wagons on this train, and the others didn't see their body come, so they all 6 stood in my compartment, and they were looking at this, and they burst out laughing. So I knew there was something wrong with it, but till after that I got out of prison. So I was brought to a prison, and anyway, I never dreamt that I would be there. And it was a small cell with brick, and it was only one little cot. And there was an old Jewish lady, I still remember her name, Mrs. Speyer, and she had that bed, and we were 5, so we slept straw on the floor, and there was no toilet, there was a big drum in the corner, and you had to do it there, whatever, no toilet paper, it was horrible. And one slice of bread in the morning, one slice in the evening, and then I never had the hearing, so I thought, oh Lord, maybe they've lost my papers, I might sit here eternally. But then in the end, I had the hearing, and that was really good, because I thought, how can I say that I have a false paper and be innocent? Anyway, it's too long, a complicated story, and I've only an hour. But then the invasion came. But before that, one girl was taken out, and every Tuesday and Thursday nights, that were the horrible nights because they were arresting by arresting, and it was a big prison, and they even made a longer part on it. And then you heard kids scream, "Mama, mama, mama." The Jewish people were rounded up, and they separated the kids, and their kids went to the gas chamber. And if the father was strong, he had to work. And if the mother was not strong, she also went to the gas chamber. But we didn't know that at that time, but it was really horrible. And then when we were all loaded, oh, this girl came in my cell, and she had very wild eyes. And she told me, because the others thought she was crazy. She was number 5. And I thought, no, there is something with this girl. And she started talking to me, and we sat on the floor because we didn't have chairs. The whole night she told me her story. She was the secretary of Churchill and of De Gaulle and all the people in Free London still. And they had dropped people in the Netherlands to bring secrets, that they had made the list what they wanted to know, for instance, troop movements and so on. And she had to report that all, and she was the secretary, so she knew so much. And she told me, I have a blank now, her name, but anyway, she says, "Diet, if I am taken prisoner, and I was a year and a half in solitary," can you imagine? She was dropped to get news because the men were all arrested and they thought I would be shot, and she volunteered to be dropped in the night while all the 19 had disappeared. I mean, to me, she is the bravest woman I ever met. Anyway, she told me the whole story, and she said, "If they take me out of here, that means circumcision impatient," because she says, "I would under no fall in the hands of the Allies. I know too much." And then she was taken out of the prison, and a few days later was the invasion. And then something also was scary, because my prison was on the edge of the dunes in the Netherlands. And in the dunes, then the North Sea, there was only one thing. Nobody, it was forbidden territory. And there was only one place, and that was the place of execution. If you were sentenced to death, you rode to the dunes and you were shot. And that was knowledge, but nobody was allowed to go there. It was what they call Sperrgebiet. And Trixter Wind was her name. And Trix told me, she said, "If I'm taken out of the prison here, that means circumcision invasion," and she was taken out. And so then I thought, now come invasion, and sure it came. And then we were all loaded in trains, and we brought to a concentration camp. And that is when I met Corrie and Betsy ten Boom, because I sat in the same compartment. We were packed, and Corrie was in her 50s, and I was 21 or something. So I sat on the floor, and Corrie and Betsy hadn't seen each other in a long time, and the tears were streaming down their cheeks, and they were holding hands. Anyway, then we went in that concentration camp, and I make it now real short, but I had on my false papers. I couldn't say teacher or nurse or whatever. And because then they could check which hospital, where do so, I said maid. And an elderly couple had vouched, they would vouch that I was their maid. So they made me wash everything by hand. The uniforms were dry clean with the underwear of the Gestapo. And it was by hand. And it was so much that I got 2 girls to help me. And there was always a guard watching. And the Gestapo had the SS sign, and we hated that sign. And I never forget that one time the guard who watched us was a woman, and she went away. Later she smelled of beer, so she went probably for a beer, but we were a moment alone. And then we held that hated shirt with the swastika on it, and we got a nice big cup of saliva. Boom. And you know, we did this every time, and I got so good. I could say, "Do you want it on your right eye or your left eye?" So that was, and then later when we were out and free, then Corrie ten Boom asked me to speak to one of her friends who was a psychologist. And I said to him, when I told him this, you must think that we were crazy. Well, we were facing death, that we got such a fun out of spitting on that swastika. And he said, no, he said, they tried your spirit. They tried to break your spirit. So anyway, I'll go now quick to the end. We heard the heavy artillery in the distance, in that concentration camp. And that is, that was Eisenhower and de Gaulle, and they were real close by. And then the Germans did not want us to be free, and they did a terrible thing. They took all the men, and they took them in the woods, and we heard every sunset, we heard shots. And there was one girl in my camp, and that was Hanny Jansen. And she always was, when we had to go for hearing, we were scared stiff. That was life or death. She was called out 3 times a week, and she never was scared. And she came back, and she had a suntan. And it was May, June, July, August. I said, I thought she's a spy. She sits here, plit. And she always ate. She had enough. She was not hungry. And she was a spy. Afterward, they told me, the government. So I used her. it's too much in detail. But Hanny Jansen was the spy, and she got very scared. Then when the Allies were so close by, and they had shot the men, they opened the camp. And when other girl, they had shot the men, and her husband was shot. She didn't know it. And she found in the camp out that she was pregnant. And they brought the two of us to outside. And God has a sense of humor too, because the entrance of the camp was big, but there was a little side door, and then you came on a sand path. There was nothing. So that is why they brought us, the two of us. And we thought, what do we do here? And then we didn't know if we should go right or left, but we wanted to get out because they were so mean and they could open it up and say, ha-ha, was a big joke, come back in. So we wanted, and then we saw a little dot, and we said, let's see what that is. So we walked, and it was on a Saturday, and the farmers didn't get any fertilizer or what, so they kept all the poo of the horses and the cows, and every Saturday, they loaded that in a wooden cart and they spread it out over the field. And of course, they never scrubbed that car. And this was the 4th year of the war, and that was such a cart. And it was caked on everywhere. And the farmer walked next to it. And when he saw us, he said, girls, you come out of the camp? Yes. He said, hop on. He said, I'll bring you to the station. So I think that God has a terrific sense of humor that we hopped on that stinking poop car. And so I went into freedom. And they brought us to the railroad station, and there was a lady from the Red Cross, and we got tickets. But I was under a false name, and I was born in another city, and I didn't trust anybody. They said, where do you want to go from the Red Cross? And I took the city of that thing where I'd never been. But anyway, so then we got out, and then the war was quite soon over. But after that I got out, I was so convinced of the evil that I went in spying. And I held everything, and I sent messages, and I don't know, there's here a gentleman in the Grand Rapids, and his name is Ralph Hauenstein. And de Gaulle and Churchill were the boss, but nobody is now 100. He was the head of the Secret Service. He knew everything. And he said that he got a lot of information from the Netherlands. Anyway, so then I was out, and I went more in than ever. And then we were... I think my time might be up, is it?
Nope, ten minutes.
Well, then I want to tell you something funny also, because one girl in our barrack started screaming, and I still remember her name, Wietzke Wilson. And then we didn't know what was the matter, and outside were all guards. Always the windows were open because we stank. We had no showers or anything, no toilet paper, no nothing. So the windows were open, but those soldiers were, and if you just leaned out because in the distance were beautiful purple. It was not the flowers, but it were in the wild, and they were so beautiful. And then I went time, I leaned out, and the clouds were so beautiful, and I thought of God's faithfulness, and that nothing happens without His will. And I was looking, and a bullet passed by, so I went quick inside. So, but I mean, it was so. And then Hanne Jansen, I found out, had an affair with one of those guards. And she climbed every night, another girl alerted me. And so who the heck has an affair with one of those Nazis? So she was the spy who always had enough food and was 10. So that, and they said she has an affair, she climbs out of the window, and then in the morning she climbs back. And the windows were all wide open because it was, you know, the guards were there. So then one time, I with another girl, we said, shall we get her? So we didn't sleep, and we slipped out at 3 or 4 in the morning, and we closed all the windows. And then she couldn't climb back in. And then you had a bell, you know, you had a stand and a roll call, you call it. And so every morning, so then, and everybody had a turn that you had to report 170 prisoners, 8 in bed, that they were sick or whatever. So it was, that morning was my turn. So I had done so stupid. In the, you know, I stood, you had to stand like that, so I stood like that. It's a terrible offense in the Netherlands at that time if you spoke to a superior or your teacher and you had your hands in your pocket. That's a local thing. But it was so rude. And so I always had my hands in my prison dress and they yelled at me, neem die handen aus die tasche, take your hands out of your pocket. So, and I said, I don't know what you're saying. Can you say it in Dutch? I did so stupid. So anyway, then we had Hanne outside and she was running around trying to get in and she couldn't. And then on the, and so she couldn't get in. And that morning I had to do the appel. So I said, there should be 178 prisoners, but I only count 177. But maybe I'm wrong. I said, yeah, stupid Willie is of course wrong. So they started counting, but then Hanne was missing. And they found her, of course, because they knew that she had that affair. And then she was for punishment a month in the bunker. The bunker was the horrible thing. She never was there. She had a real good time with the other guys. So, and the, oh, here goes my hearing aid. Can they still hear me? Can you still hear me or not? Thank you. Anyway. After the war, they came from the Dutch government to me, and they said, did you know Hanne Jansen? I said, yes. What do you think of her? I said that she was a spy, and then they told me that she was always dating officers, and England took an officer there who was fluent in German because he had been the son of an ambassador, and they gave him a high German uniform, and they dropped him. And she was seeing lots of guys. She was kind of a prostitute. So he wormed himself in her circle. And then he became engaged to her. But he was so liberal, she could see all the other officers. But then in bed, she got all information from the other officers. And this was told to this guy. And it all went to England. And sometimes England knew it before that the lower... So it was Hanne, really, but we had her, and she was put in prison. But then, at the end, when they were shooting all the guys, then I had a terrible time, because I didn't know if Hein was among it, and because I was so-called a maid, there were big troughs that we had to wash ourselves in, and that's where we had to wash the underwear of those Gestapo guys. But then one day, we got 7 or 2 first, all underwear covered with blood. And I asked the wachtmeisterin, she was when we could speak a little bit of Dutch. And she heard me one time I was singing something about God's faithfulness very softly when I was alone in the washroom. And she said, "Sie singen wie ein Heidelerche. You sing like a heatherlark." But I was praising God and praying to him. Anyway, she could speak some Dutch. And so I asked her, I said, "What is happening, Miss Those Guys, when you hear that shooting?" She said, "Oh, that Dutch traitors, they are all being shot." And that's when I lost it. I think, God, here we are nearly free. They're so close by, and they're all being shot, and all those women were widows. And that was terrible. I was totally paralyzed for 3 days. That's the worst time in my life that I can think of. Anyway, then I was let out with this answer, and then with the car we went back, and then I went full blast in spying and everything. And I can only say to the young people here, you never know what your life brings. But I escaped. I had a bobby pin, and they did not take that out. And I escaped in the brick of the wall of my cell. Lo, I am with you, always. And that is such a consolation. Whatever happens, God is always with us. And that's what happens everywhere, because I remember one day, it was towards the end of the war, and it was cold and rainy, and you had no clothes anymore, and there were no trains anymore, and no cars, and I had to walk, let's say, from here to Ludington or something. And it was cold, and I had a backpack on, and I had to bring some messages, and it was very urgent. And all of a sudden, I was overwhelmed. I never forget it. And I said, "Lord, I've had it. I find somebody else." And you know what? My parents, they had my oldest brother went to Indonesia. He was there tortured to death by the Japs. But my parents had a little diary, a Christian diary. First a text, then a little scripture, and then a prayer or a hymn. And so when my brother went to Indonesia, they gave him the same with a newer print. When I went to Venezuela, or when I was roaming around, they gave that to me. And they gave it to my younger brother and my sister. So they said, if we read the all other edition, but they said, if we read it every day, we are united in that one thought, you know, the prayer. And I remember that day that I said to God, "Find somebody else, I've had it." And I opened at night my diary, and it said, "Being exhausted, still continuing." So I got my orders, and the next morning I put my backpack on again, and I went again. And then we were liberated, and that was so wonderful. Oh, and if you have not experienced that, that the Allies came, and we were in the part where I was, were the Canadians. Oh, it was unbelievable. So I don't know if I...
Good. About 3 minutes.
Well, I can only say to everybody, whatever happens, and like we sang tonight, that your life goes often totally different. But one thing, God is always there. And also, I thought it was very hard. And I read, we are just, and I think the young people from this church or the ladies are studying James, and me too. And it starts with be grateful or be joyful when you encounter trials and tribulations, because it will make you stronger. But it's a difficult time, a difficult thing to be joyful when everything is against you. But you know what? Your prayers are totally different. If everything goes so smooth, your prayer is totally different, and you will have experienced that in your life. When it's really hard, then you pray totally different. And it's so wonderful that we know that our Father always hears. And before we have prayed, he knows it already, and he takes care of us. And that's the only way how you can get forward in life. And the young people too, whatever happens in your life, and there is not one life that from that you're born till the day you die that you don't get a heavy burden to bear. There's not one. But when that happens, God is right there. and your prayers are much deeper. And I'm thanking God if they say, would you have wanted to miss those 5 years? I always know that was the closest that I was to God. And so it is sometimes good. Joyful is a difficult word to be in trials, but he is there always. Thank you. Thank you. Have done the same. If you had been in the Netherlands and you had to choose when they started on the Jewish people, anybody who loves God would have helped. So it's nothing special. So
I'm going to close in prayer.
I would like to close in prayer. Father God, you are sovereign. You are almighty. I thank you so much for this precious, precious woman. Lord, who is the most courageous woman I know, I thank you for her message. I thank you, Lord, that you spared her life. And we know how difficult, I know how difficult it is, Lord, for her to come and to speak and to always remember, Lord, but I'm thankful that she has been called to share her story. I pray that you would use it, Lord, in the lives of each of us here, Lord, to inspire us, not to be comfortable, Lord, but just to really live out our faith. I pray that for each young child here, Lord, like you used Corrie Ten Boom's story so long ago in my life, just to draw me to you, Lord. I pray that you would use Deet's story to help them, to give them the courage, to, Lord, to stand up for what's right, to live out their faith, Father. Bless us all as we go our separate ways, Lord. Bless this precious woman. Thank you so much for this church and for each person here. We love you, Lord, in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
No. You're good. Okay. I want to say there are elderly people here too, and I read something so beautiful. The last verse of Jude, and that is, to him who is able to keep you from falling and from doing sin, he will present you to the Father with faultless and with great joy. Now just think how beautiful that is. When we die, Jesus will introduce you to the Father, introduce us to the Father without fault and with great joy. Now, is there anything more beautiful? Thank you.